Just going to run through quickly the action items. Obviously, we're going to be posting this to our YouTube site, so we encourage you to visit YouTube after this presentation if you'd like to rewatch the presentation or pass this along to any colleagues that you have. We'd like to also get any questions or thoughts that you have. Please send those to the Q&A function, the chat function. I will be collecting them and posing them to Ezra at the end of the session. We also will be sending out the slides to everyone that attends today's webinar within 24 hours. We're also posting these slides as well as other thought leadership pieces, webinar decks, and commentaries on our SlideShare site, which is www.slideshare.net/TBR_market_insight. And I'll share all these social media links, so if you didn't catch them the first time, they will be available for you to get at the end of the presentation. So with that, let me introduce Research Principal Analyst Ezra Gothow from the computing team here at TBR. Ezra leads our coverage of HP hardware, Lenovo, and Apple, and is the principal researcher on projects including consumer and business tablets, PC warranties, PC supply chains, mobile device strategies, mobile device management, app stores, and social networking. He's been covering the computing industry for over 20 years, and his insight has proven invaluable to our hardware and devices clients. And with that, let me hand this over to Ezra.
Thank you, Allison. Today we're going to run quickly through some aspects of why we go about trying to foresee the future, an impossible, not merely difficult task, the tools we use, and give you a brief overview of what we see going on in the product categories. And then we'll get to what I think is the juicy part of the presentation, a selection of special topics, things we think that are important, trends important, things on the horizon. So let's move on. Next slide, please. Why are we predicting? Why are we trying to figure out what is more or less likely? Because our clients, many of you, are trying to strategize, allocate resources, execute, measure against their execution, and repeat the process. They're placing big bets in a very volatile industry at an important time. And basically what we do is we help you decide where to push those chips. Your processes and ours are not actually all that different. When I talk about predicting the future, I'm describing something that you do and we do, and we can help you do. Next slide, please. Let's talk very quickly about volatility. As you can tell from the picture, I've got some gray hair. I've been through two times of very great disruption in our industry, the very first being the PC, which I think smartphones and tablets parallel at that time, the second being the Internet, and finally here we're going on with multiple devices. And why is it moving so quickly? The technology development is very fast. That's always true at the very early part of the history of a product. We're actually beginning to see it slow down a little bit in smartphones, which is one of the reasons why the reviews of all the introductions is same old, same old. The data synchronization and cloud have really allowed us to go from there being barriers before having more than one device to having as many devices as you want. And I think the real crossing of the chasm here was from one to many, not from one to two and then from two to three. And I think that is a real indicator of the way to see how things are going to be happening going forward. Right now, as is often the case, as was the case with PCs, the change is consumer driven. And consumers have many unusual characteristics, but one of them is that they can make a decision a lot faster than institutions. And that's a reason that things are moving so quickly. That's why companies are skyrocketing and sometimes crashing and sometimes skyrocketing, crashing, and pulling off a recovery. But in a time like this, it's very important to get what information you can, figure out what's more and less likely, and take action. So that's why we think that you and we are working so hard to see in a very difficult environment. Social media is a big driver. It moves people together in away from and toward buying decisions, and it contributes to the volatility. Next slide, please. So what are we looking to do if we can't really predict the future? It's hard very even to know exactly what's happening now. Rather than predict the future. We're not saying this is going to happen, this will not happen. We're saying the likelihood of this happening is greater than we otherwise would have thought. That likelihood is less lower than we other would have thought. We are manipulating our odds of things happening and our confidence, both of things happening and in strategies working. We're looking at scenarios, and frankly, nothing will happen that you can't tell a story about. So we're looking at things that might happen so you can look at alternatives, so you can consider other ways of approaching the future. And finally, we're looking to balance risk and reward. We're looking at a kind of game theory approach to investing and to making strategic decisions. If I do this, what is likely to happen? What is more and less likely to happen? What's the upside? What's the downside? How will other actors react? Next slide, please. All this comes down to finding ways to improve your vision in a very murky, cloudy, foggy, uncertain environment. There's a bunch of tools we use, and as I say, you do too. One is we try to take in all the information we can, including in the far reaches of the horizon, not only the distant future, but off to the side. Adjacent technologies, adjacent markets, adjacent social trends all affect what's going to happen in the IT industry. We here at TBR are particularly specialized in measuring the present. We're a numbers-based organization. We take those numbers and we imply strategic direction, we imply judgment, we imply probability, but we measure what's going on right now. And we use two tools to do that more often than others. We use a financial modeling where we have great strength, and we use a number of survey tools, online surveys, person-to-person telephone surveys, and online focus groups. We watch for trends, we watch for violations of trends, but prediction is far more than drawing a ruler line through a graph and saying it's going to keep going in the other direction. Another of our specialties is looking at companies as whole companies and tracking them over a period of time. The thing that allows us to do is get a great sense of the personalities, of the tendencies of the actors upon this stage, and seeing how the whole company will react, and predicting how it will react will give you greater confidence in how your success will be determined by your actions. We look at history. History doesn't rhyme. History doesn't repeat itself. Mark Twain said it sometimes rhymes. We find that helpful. We examine things with empathy for the actors. We think it's very important to understand what the potential customers are going to feel, what the competitors are going to feel, what the partners are going to feel. We take the roles of all the players in this scenario. If you want to see a company that failed to show a certain amount of empathy for its customers, think of Maker's Mark Bourbon, who thought their customers would be pleased if they watered down the bourbon. How well did that work out? We put these stories into scenarios. We're looking to figure out a sequence of things that makes sense, that fall together, that puts together a series of activities, actions, and reactions, and what is likely to happen, and we evaluate the whole scenarios. And we tell those scenarios as stories. Stories have an upside and a downside. The upside is the scenarios fill out. You can identify gaps. You can really understand potential multiplayer activities. The downside is the stories are a very convincing thing, and you can fall in love with a story that really doesn't have a lot of probability or data to support it. So we test those stories against the hard data, against our colleagues, against our partners, against our customers. But coming up with new stories is an important part of the process. Next slide, please. So that's a roll-up of the kinds of things we do based on hard data, based on industry experience, based on following the history of the companies and of the technologies and of the markets. We make some predictions and we help our clients make predictions. Let's talk about where we think we are in just kind of a snapshot. We've got PCs. There's been a lot of talk about the death of PCs. They're not dying, they're not going away, but they've definitely reached a mature stage. And going forward indefinitely, we see them as flat, slightly down, slightly up, depending on the growth of the total available market, but never again achieving the kind of growth they once achieved. Still an important player, and player I believe where there are opportunities for profit, if not so much for growth or total growth. Certainly some companies will grow. In handsets, while we've seen a certain amount of maturing in that market at the very top, it's still, in terms of additional units sold each day, week, month, quarter, the fastest growing product in history of almost any kind. And that will continue to be the case. One of the reasons it's a robust product, even as the markets begin to saturate, is because the way we buy them leads to a very rapid refresh cycle. So that's going to continue to be a very important growing market for a very long time, and we'll address how it can grow even further than it currently seems possible. Tablets have the very highest rate of growth. That is to say, when you compute a percentage growth, you see the most rapid growth in tablets. And tablets are a long-term player, and we believe we'll achieve a place in the set of devices owned by almost every user. They're still in the rapid refresh cycle phase, although we haven't even largely gotten to the first cycle of refresh. So continued rapid growth, eventually ending up at a far lower penetration than smartphones, because in resource-constrained markets, the tablet is not as necessary as either the PC or the smartphone. Then the next class are things that are actually happening now. TVs, smart TVs have not yet reached the point where they're driving a refresh cycle in TVs, but they're becoming increasingly a default feature in TVs. We think there's a lot of legs left in the smart TV movement, largely be driven by availability of content and integration with other devices. Next is a category that we have identified, and we will discuss further, which is lightweight keyboard devices. That Chromebook is the first entry in that class, and we think that has a real future. Wearable and embedded are both categories that have a long-term big future. We don't see them ever going through a phase of very rapid adoption as things like the smartphone and the tablet have gone through, but we see them increasingly playing a role in the Internet of Things. Next slide, please. So let's get on to the interesting things. So here are four topics, four things to think about going forward. The first one is going to be the extending life cycle of PCs and what do we do about them. The next is the return of the keyboard. That's those lightweight keyboard devices I mentioned. The next is the results of our surveys on tablets. People love, 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 love their tablets. And finally, the next 5 billion is how do we transform all the users of feature phones into smartphone users, and what are the opportunities there? Let's move on. Next slide, PC longevity. Okay, what we know is that PC sales fell well, well, well off, and we know that most people who had a PC are continuing to use a PC. Therefore, we can reasonably conclude that people are holding on to their PCs longer. We don't have a hard measure on that. We're trying to get some of those data, and we'll be reporting on it when we can. The consequence of that, and it's perfectly reasonable, and we think it actually started quite a while ago. We think the first cycle of extending the PC life cycle was during the big recession in 2008, 2009. And then one of the things that's caused the fall off in PC sales is that PCs that were sold into the refresh cycle from that recession are still usable, and that's one of the reasons people can put off buying a new PC. We see this happening both in consumer and commercial. The PCs themselves last longer, they're tougher. The vendors, that is to say largely you guys, have addressed the places of vulnerability on them, and they don't break as often as they used to. Plus, they're more than adequately powerful for what most people do with PCs, so there's no reason to update the newer models, while a good deal more powerful and capable. Don't do the basic jobs any better because basically they're fast enough. And finally, they are definitely being cannibalized. They're being cannibalized by secondary PCs. That is to say, most people who buy a tablet have a PC. There are a few and an increasing number who don't, but the majority of the cannibalization is where people used to have a second or a third PC. Now they're putting that money and time and effort and into their other devices, primarily into tablets. Next slide. So, obviously this has some bad news, and this is a summation of a bunch of the major vendors our modeling and estimates of their operating profit for their consumer PCs. Apple is not in that list, because if Apple were in the list, then it would be positive, and I wanted to paint a dire picture. But what you see is the slowing sales have contributed not only to decreasing revenue, but as companies try to keep their volume up, to considerable pressure on margins. Frankly, the consumer PC segment, being so commoditized and price sensitive, had been sick for a very long time, and it continues to suffer. But there is good news, or at least potential good news. So, if people are going to keep their PCs longer, we in the vendor end of the world can help transform the way they buy PCs. We've seen this happen with another major purchase, and that is the motor vehicle, where motor vehicles used to be a 3-4 year deal, and you could get them for, I can remember, very small dollars, at least by today's standards. But if our buyers are figuring now that they're going to be holding on to a PC for a good deal longer, we have the opportunity to tell them a different story, to make them a different value proposition, to offer a different set of services to accompany them that basically says, the decision you're making now on your PC is one you're going to be living with for a while. Don't you want to have a satisfactory relationship with your PC and with your vendor? Under those circumstances, we can expect an ability to drive higher priced sales. We can expect longer service relationships and more deeper and broader service relationships. And that, in turn, puts us in a relationship with our customers, who in many cases just bought the cheapest thing at Best Buy and ran away in the past. And one opportunity there, one we want to explore further, is actually providing the device, the PC, as a service, ensuring that it continues to be up, running, populated with data and applications, fully licensed, and under all circumstances, on a combination lease and service subscription basis. We think that's a potential real winner, and one that the PC vendors should be examining. Next slide, please. So let's move on. What do I mean by tablet love? When we've done repeated surveys now on tablets dating back to very shortly after the availability of the iPad, and we get satisfaction rankings that are insane. These respondents know that their tablets don't do everything. They know that there are weaknesses. They know relative to other devices, they're limited. But they just love their tablets. They love them, as I say here, beyond utility, in spite of limitations. Next slide, please. So what do we think is going on? We think that there's a lot to love about a tablet. First of all, it is genuinely a useful device. It does only some things. And part of the reason that it's satisfactory is you know what things it does. You don't expect it largely to do things that it doesn't do, or at least you don't anymore. Back in the very early days, people were expecting to substitute their tablet for their PC and create documents on them, and those people were disappointed, but people don't have that expectation. By transparency, we mean what to do with what you can do with them and how to do it is much more obvious than it is with a PC. They're, relative to a PC, much simpler. The specialization, the limitation relative to PC is actually an upside in terms of the feelings people have about those devices. I know what it does. I know what it does well. It delivers entertainment. Yes, you can do practical work. Certainly not all emails pleasant. But there's an awful lot of just fun that comes in via your tablet. So you're getting just the good parts of the potential of all the technology. So what's not to love? But the main thing you're getting is it's not a hassle. It doesn't puzzle you. It doesn't make you feel stupid. You don't generally have to ask people how to do things. The implications for that is that as you are going into that market, you have to bear that in mind. And a lot of you are looking at Windows 8 tablet devices. And Windows 8 as a tablet is a very strong product. I have one in front of me right now, and there's a lot to love there, but there's a lot to say it's just a PC. So as a device that has some of the virtues of a tablet but is really a PC, we think Windows 8 has real near-term potential. To have long-term potential, a lot of the things that make it so obviously PC, whether you want it to be or not, have to be ameliorated. Obviously, the apps, the available apps have to be filled out, but also a lot of the controls have to be migrated into the new interface. It has to be, in all these many ways, just like a tablet. If you're going to sit down and you know, run a fancy Excel spreadsheet, people are perfectly happy it being a PC. They're happy that their tablet can transmogrify itself into a PC. But when it's being a tablet, it has to be a tablet. It can't be showing you Windows settings dialogues or anything like that. So we believe the Windows 8 tablet has a real future. We think it has near-term traction. But ultimately, to play in the world of tablets where people love them so much, the tablet half has to be filled out. Next slide, please. Let's talk about the return of the keyboard. So what's going on with Chromebook? As our numbers indicate and other numbers indicate, the Chromebook is having a fair amount of success. And it actually makes sense that we think about why people like their tablets. People need keyboards, and you know, probably the single biggest drawback of a tablet is that it doesn't have a built-in keyboard, and even the external keyboards are a pain in the neck. Because not only does it need a keyboard, it needs a pointing device other than my chubby little fingertip. I need to be able to pick a letter out with the pointing device. So you need something like a touchpad. And where those two worlds meet, the world of no hassle in the world of a usable keyboard is with the Chromebook. And we believe there's opportunities for other devices that meet those criteria. Let's call them PCs without tiers. They're in the no hassle zone. They don't have viruses. They don't have upgrade problems. They don't ask you funky questions. But they get the job done, and they get the jobs done with the ease and transparency of a tablet, but with the additional utility of a keyboard and some kind of windowing system and things like that. So apart from Google and Chrome OS, who else can play in this space? Well, actually, Microsoft can play in this space with RT. RT was brought out as an I don't know what it is, but it has their opportunity there is to say this RT is Windows without tiers, or RT is a simplified productivity device that lets you do what you want to do without being as complex and difficult to maintain as other devices. The other obvious player is Apple, and we believe that Apple will overcome its prejudice against keyboards sometime next year and bring out some enhancements to iOS, iOS 7 then, and bring out a companion keyboard that docks or folds or does something nice with it. It has a more sophisticated pointing device because iOS is almost there. And you combine a pointing device and a well-integrated companion keyboard, and you've got an iPad Plus, and that has enormous potential. So we think those are two opportunities to establish a new class of devices. Next slide, please. So let's go to the last, and this one is more speculative than the others. And I'm going to really basically say, how did I come up with the scenario rather than evidence for the scenario. So, what limits smartphones? The really big ultimate growth into the next 5 billion users. That's what 5 billion says. Well, it's basically the cost of data plans. The devices are getting cheaper, cheaper, cheaper. People want them. Why can't you sell them? Because nobody, who doesn't have substantial extra income can pay for data feeds. What is the killer feature? I mean, smartphones do everything. They show movies, they play games, they play music, they do everything. What's the killer feature? The killer feature, I believe, is internet access. And by internet access, I don't mean streaming video or complex role-playing games. I mean the thing that made the internet a revolution in the mid-90s. Basically slow modem internet, the ability to get the information you want, the ability to conduct the transaction you want to conduct as cheaply and quickly as possible. So, given that the people can't afford the bandwidth, who makes money on there being a lot more smartphones? Apart from the the vendors and the only vendors making money now are Apple and Samsung. Who makes money? Google makes money. Facebook makes money. Stores that tell their customers when they're open make money. Probably banks that have a better interface than an SMS interface make money. Probably anything with which one can do an online transaction makes money. So what are we saying? What I'm saying is that the way to get bandwidth to the next 5 billion is through subsidization by those who benefit from the connectivity, apart from the end user, those who benefit on a transactional basis, on access time basis. And given that question, a little research indicates that both Google and Facebook have experimented with subsidized access. So they're interested in that. So that's where we think things are going, where people, in the Google experiment, for instance, you could get to Google and you could get to the first page Google linked to. With Facebook, you could use Facebook messaging, which is their attempt to disrupt other message infrastructures. So that's where we think the next wave of smartphone dispersion will come from, and it could be absolutely monumental. Okay, so that really winds us up. I'm going to open up for questions. Let's give you one of my favorite Yogi Berra quotes. It's tough to make predictions, especially about the future, but this is what we do, and this is what we love to do, and this is what we'd love to help you guys do. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ezra. Thanks for those of you who have sent your questions through already. I'd like to encourage anyone who has any questions for Ezra, please send them through now. Ezra, our first question is, how does the availability of bandwidth affect the balance between client-side and server-side computing? When do we hit enough bandwidth to alter the balance between client and server-side computing?
Okay, where there's wide, cheap bandwidth, then you get things like Chrome OS. You get the thin client and almost all the computing happening on the server. And that, by the way, is why I think that Google will and should keep Android and Chrome OS on two different tracks. Chrome OS, Android rather, is the modernization of the old thick client approach, which Apple pioneered with iOS. It takes out some of the complexity and difficulty of maintaining the thick client, but it basically lets you run disconnected or thinly connected a lot of the time. You don't have to be connected all the time on Chrome OS. It does have a standalone mode, but you really have to have access to broadband sometimes. So it's a matter of what's available at what price, exactly how the load will be distributed between client and server.
Okay, the next question. What functionality will the PC actually provide in the future? Is the PC a thin client or a high-powered 8-core device?
I think the PC is a high-powered 8-core device. I mean, it certainly can run thin clients on top of it. But I think as the PC retreats to its core capabilities, it becomes, you know, the absolute do-all power device for do-all power users.
Okay. What about server-side cloud computing? How does this affect all of the devices on your list?
Well, every single one of these devices increases the demand for server-side cloud computing. But no matter what you do, any cycle executed in a server, even an ARM, even all the things we do to try to make servers more efficient, is far more expensive than cycles executed at the client end. So to the extent that it's possible, we'll still have a very distributed system.
Okay. Why can't I just use my smartphone to satisfy the needs currently addressed by tablets? Isn't a smartphone even less hassle?
I think it is. I think it's equivalent hassle. That's not the issue. The issue is it has hardware constraints. The larger it is, so you can more easily read it or view a screen, the less easily it carries or fits in your pocket. I don't see a large amount of distinction between smartphones and tablets. And I eventually see a kind of continuity, much like we see in automobiles, where the size and form factor settle on certain clusters as the competitors define them, And we may even see the same effect as the cluster of the given name gets larger and larger and larger until a new cluster is established at the bottom end. But it's purely a trade-off of the physical characteristics of the device.
Why do I need an iPad to interface with my keyboard if my iPhone does the same thing and now runs MS Office?
I personally wouldn't try to do a spreadsheet on my phone unless it were many sizes larger. Frankly, I do Excel on two or three monitors when given the opportunity, and that's not easy given Excel. So I think, again, yes, one can do it. One can park one's smartphone in the docking base of one's keyboard and do everything one wants, but it's purely the physical constraints of the device.
Okay. How might bring your own PC trends affect consumer PC purchases? Buy a higher spec PC, upgraded service support plan, etc.
Frankly, I think BYOPC will only have an impact in the contractor economy. I think companies want the security and the manageability of devices that they completely control. I don't think that the BYOD trend goes in the same direction indefinitely. I think there is a wave that comes back against it and says, okay, smartphones, sure, use any smartphone you want as long as it, you know, you can isolate our data from your data and various other characteristics. I think tablets are going to have similar rules as, you know, in majority cases, to smartphones. We will give you email and web access, but we won't let you run core applications. And I don't see a whole lot of future of bring one's own PC unless you're a hired gun who, you know, comes in with your, I don't know if any of you know about your pool cue in a case. I mean, that's a different matter entirely.
Okay. Why does Apple need to embrace keyboards for iPad when there are a variety of BT keyboards, docking devices available today?
Well, as I said, I think a third-party keyboard and some enhancements to iOS could work, but I don't know of any third-party keyboards that have a much better pointing device. I don't know if iOS really supports a much better pointing device. I think that pointing device is pretty important. And then I think integration is pretty important as well. I think it should make a nice package. Frankly, I'm a little surprised that Apple didn't earlier, even without the pointing device, come up with a companion keyboard that mated well with the iPad.
Okay. When talking about longer service relationships with customers, what kind of services are you thinking of?
Okay, so the thing here is if you're saying, you know, stay with us for a long time, you're going to be happy for a long time, you basically have to keep that PC up running, secure, and running well. So we're talking about online backup and restore, including restoration to a drop ship replacement device if you have an insurance coverage. We're talking probably about some kind of tune-up service to deal with WinRot. We may be talking about annual subscriptions to software, so you don't have to make a high initial investment in software as well. That's the kind of thing that I think would make you have an ongoing relationship with your customer.
Okay. Do you see this positive response to tablets continuing indefinitely?
I see it. People continuing to own them and be happy with them, but the joyfulness, I think, eventually, we just get used to the good things, and we say, well, this is really nice. I'm glad I have it. But right now, there's still this sense of wonder, and I think that probably will continue as they more rapidly evolve. Thinner and lighter is clearly a big win for tablets, and that's going to be the major direction for a while.
Okay, we just had another question come through, and so if I butcher this word, please forgive me. When do phablets start to eat away at tablets, if ever?
I think they are. I think they are the same thing. And what we're looking at is a proliferation of differentiation inside a broad market. I don't see it as a big deal. But, you know, there's going to be a part of the market that wants it. And since the market is growing, You know, it's hard to determine what's denting what and what's simply identifying new opportunities inside a growing market.
Okay. What are the business implications of lightweight keyboard devices?
Okay. So the longer story when you look at lightweight keyboard devices, or specifically Chromebooks in particular, is that they're closely paired with Google Apps. Google Apps is a rapidly growing software family that is making some real inroads on Microsoft Office. I think Outlook is terribly vulnerable to the Gmail, which is the heart of it. When you think of Google Apps, don't think much about the spreadsheets and word processors. Think about the Mail app, because that's everybody's core app, and it's where a lot of strategic things are happening. In that context, where there are large institutions that are finding that they can use Google Apps, and for a significant number of their users, they can use Google Apps as the only thing they buy. They basically don't need Microsoft Office. A large part of their user base doesn't need PowerPoint. They just need to be able to see PowerPoint presentations. In that context, you can see those organizations doing the same kind of split and saying, hey, wait a minute. I don't even really need these people to have a whole PC. So I see there being a potential down the road, especially with Chromebook, but also with RT, of large enterprises looking at their user base and saying, these are my power users, they get full-fledged PCs. These are my user users. Everybody needs to be plugged in. Everybody needs our web apps. Everybody needs our email. These things are not only less expensive, they have considerably lower TCO. We're going to divide our user base this way, and I think that there's an impact there.
Okay. We have one more question, it looks like. With your scenario for the next $5 billion, what are the implications for devices vendors?
Well, I think the main thing is there's a market there. It's a commodity market. It's going to be tough. But it's where a lot of them have been playing in the past in feature phones. I mean, these were, you know, low-margin, low-cost devices, and that's what's going to happen. There's an operating system implication that I think device vendors have to pay attention to, which is probably Android is both too heavy and too well-defined in its own space as being the appropriate OS for devices that are smart. There are smartphones. They have web, you know, they have good web access and all that, but they're not full-fledged, you know, smartphones with a fairly extensive and rapidly evolving fancy OS. So I think that you need to identify a different platform. I think it also has some real opportunities for server software vendors, because if in fact the scenario says, you know, we're going to go back to internet where you just put the letters on the screen, then software that converts fancier websites into simple bandwidth conservative websites have a real opportunity.
Great. It looks like there aren't any other questions. So with that, I think we'd like to wrap up. There are a couple quick things I'd like to mention. First of all, we're going to be doing more of these thought leadership webinars with Ezra starting in the fall. So please stay tuned. We'd like to have you guys all join us for those. One of the things that we'd like to ask is there's a brief survey as you're exiting the webinar talking about or asking you about the quality of the presentation and the presenter. If there are certain topics that you would like Ezra to look at in more detail, please put that into the open comments section so we can take a look at that for our ongoing series. It's going to be starting sometime in either September or October of this year. With that, I'd like to thank everyone for your questions and your time today, and thank Ezra for his time. I'm going to leave the chat function open for another couple of minutes if you have any last-minute questions. And I've also shared with you through the chat function I've sent out to everyone information on our YouTube channel name as well as our channel on SlideShare. So if you'd like to check out any information there, please feel free to do so. And as I mentioned, we'll be sending out the slides tomorrow. So thanks, everyone, for your time. If you have any last-minute questions, we look forward to chatting with you. And have a great afternoon, everyone.
Thank you very much.